Went and did press for 4 days, and then I went from there to Prague, Prague to Russia.
Yes.
A quick stop in Russia, and then I've flown from Russia right now, 2 hours before I arrived here to see you. But there you are. It's been quite a day.
Jazz Coleman has been the frontman for the band Killing Joke since 1978. He's also had a career as a classical composer for almost as long. He co-founded York Street Studios in Auckland and has produced music by Kiwis such as Shehard, Emma Paki and Henewehi Mohi. And he joins me today as my guest on the Mixtape. Jazz, welcome.
Hi. You missed out the fact that I've also worked with the Auckland Philharmonic, New Zealand Symphony Orchestra, New Zealand String Quartet, and that I changed your national anthem. So it has to be sung at least 50% in Māori by law.
I had a limited amount of time, but that last one's amazing, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. It is. Of course, when you go to your daughter's graduation at university and you hear the national anthem back, because I've got two Kiwi daughters, it is remarkable, and you can thank Hinawehi and myself for that. You know, considering that we got death threats and hate mail from rednecks for our efforts, but then it changed after that.
Absolutely, yeah. It did, yeah.
Yeah. Oh, it's amazing to be back in Aotearoa.
How long has it been since you were here?
Oh, I was back, I was February, March, April. I've been here a couple of times this year. I mean, I don't live anywhere. I miss Peru sometimes, Costa Rica sometimes, Russia sometimes. I move around, and then we're on the road the rest of the time.
You're a nomad.
Yeah, I am. I've been living that way for a while. I tried to sort of settle down for a while with a partner that I've been with for 6 years, and she couldn't take this sort of nomadic lifestyle anymore. So I tried it, and I just couldn't do it. And then I realised I must be some kind of adrenaline junkie after that, because I need to be in a permanent state of excitement stroke fear.
You get bored.
I do, very easily, very quickly.
Mm. I want to talk to you about this more.
Yeah.
But I want to talk about your album to kick things
off,
your brand new album.
Yeah.
You recorded this with the St. Petersburg Philharmonic Orchestra, and
it
is called Magna Invocatio.
Yeah, yeah. My classical career started when I was four. I was pretty successful by the time I was 12. I'd sung in cathedral choirs, and I was pretty good as a violinist. And then I won international awards, and then by 14, I got into rock music, experimental rock music. By the time punk kicked in, by the time I was 22, I decided to study the orchestra. I made a list of the top people in the world who were alive, and I just sort of banged hard on the door. The first guy was a guy called Klaus Tenstedt, who lived behind the Iron Curtain but conducted the LSO and Berlin Philharmonic, and he was my first point of contact. He was responsible for setting me off on a journey. I sent my first score to him, and then he sent me first on a journey that took me from Leipzig, which is communist then, to Minsk in Belarusia, where I basically studied on different people, ending up with a Hungarian master who actually I'm still with, and the launch party last week for Magna Invocatio, I invited my master, who I've been with since 1988,
wow.
To sort of experience the whole thing. So the first record I ever bought was at the age of eight, and it was Russian Orchestral Masterpieces. And then, of course, the last 7-8 years, I've been working as composer in residence, first for the State Orchestra and then secondly for the Philharmonic. Yeah, and of course, my big break came in New Zealand when I emigrated here. I worked with NZSO, NZSO and Auckland Philharmonic, and became composer in residence of the Auckland Phil. And then 6 weeks after that, I was with LSO, and I just did so many records in a row. It just went like dominoes and massive sales. I mean, I've got multi-million sales with classical music now.
Wow.
So, yeah, and I'm signed to Decca for the rest of my mortal lifespan.
All right.
Yeah, with classics, you know. And I just really, at this point, have to say, well, it's good to be in New Zealand now, because this is the country that gave me my first break, and this is the country where my children live and my grandchildren live. This is the country I became a citizen of and helped change the national anthem of. Mm. And I am so grateful to be part of this country.
Welcome back.
It's incredible to be back.
Let's take that opportunity to go to your first song. It is a classical piece by Elgar.
I chose this because it kind of represents my beginnings. When you listen to Nimrod from the Enigma Variations, it conjures up the England of the 60s that certainly I was born into, where you can hear the hedgerows, you can hear a lost world. You know, when I was a boy, I remember the steam engines. That's how old I am. You know, this world. And it makes me think, when I listen to this piece of music, of my beginnings and how much we've lost of our country. It makes me feel that as well. Above all, it makes me feel a lot of things. I hope you enjoy this.
That was Elgar. The piece was called Nimrod.
From the Enigma Variations.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Let's linger on the new album a little bit longer. How did you choose which Killing Joke songs you were going to adapt for the orchestra?
That was very, very difficult because, you know, to be perfectly frank, I could do another 8 records like this of Killing Joke songs. Considering that we've got somewhere around 900 songs published out there. There's plenty, there's plenty to choose from.
Yeah.
You know, that reminds me that in the 70s, they used to do these publishing deals, which actually were for 900 songs, and nobody ever lived to finish these deals. Mm. Well, Geordie Walker and myself from Killing Joke were the only people to have ever finished one of these deals and be able to sign a new deal in the history of mankind. We signed that when we were like 17 and 18.
Right.
And the other year, we got out of that deal, right? You're not meant to live that long.
Crazy.
Yeah, I was coaxed into this symphonic Killing Joke by my last manager, who's long since fired, and didn't like me anyway. He denied me access to Killing Joke's Facebook and a load of other things. A massive feud, culminating in him saying, look, we'll do a pledge thing for a symphonic Killing Joke. I'll peel 10 grand off and put it in your pocket. That didn't happen. and so suddenly I found myself, I had to find the money, and people have stolen money and taken the money from pledge. I don't know what they've done with it, put it in their pockets. You know, I mean, I've got a choice after this, whether I sue them or not. I probably will. I normally do. Anyway, so I was in this situation whereby people had pledged money that I hadn't received, and I had to deliver, again, a record. And it was turning into truly into a nightmare. The first thing that happened was I had my first dream in 25 years, because I don't dream, or if I do dream, I'm not conscious of it, you see. But this was the most incredible dream. It was, I dreamt of a winter palace that was floodlit, and there was an orchestra in full concert dress, and I was there, and the sky, the ceiling was the night sky, and I could hear the music that actually, is on Magnum Vicatio. And 2 days after this magnificent dream, I had all the funding to go to Russia. It was just magic beyond belief. And then when I went to Russia, suffice to say that the recording and the time I spent there, and I've had a very colourful life, believe you me, it was probably the peak experience of my existence.
Wow.
Yeah, so it just blew me away. So what happened is that suddenly the two sides of my life came together, and suddenly the official ceremonial music for the spiritual arm of the UN, when everybody gathers there, that is basically arranged from the fanfare. The choral fanfare is arranged from Killing Joke's music, which is amazing. Mm-hmm. After doing 41 years of Killing Joke, and I'm still with the same guys. So it's a long journey from squats in this world, yeah. I can tell you,
yeah.
To becoming knighted for classical music, and then on to my work now with Lucy's Trust and the United Nations.
Amazing.
What a journey.
Yeah. Let's go to song number two, and it's off on a slight tangent. It's 1,000 Kisses Deep by Leonard Cohen.
Oh, I love this song so much. It's the only song I really like of Leonard Cohen's, I have to
be
honest.
Is that right?
Yeah. Wow. But I love his lyrics. I love his prose, really. But when I listen to especially this song, it's of a wise old man looking back on his life, and it touches me so deeply. Perhaps that's why I relate to it.
The ponies run, the girls are young, the odds are there to beat. You win a while, and then it's done, your little winning streak. Summon now to deal with your invincible defeat. You live your life as if it's real. 1,000 kisses deep. I'm turning tricks, I'm getting fixed. I'm back on Boogie Street. You lose your grip, and then you slip into the masterpiece. And maybe I had miles to drive and promises to keep. It all. thousand kisses deep, confined to sex, we pressed against the limits of the sea. I saw there were no oceans left for scavengers like me. I made it to the forward deck. I blessed our remnant fleet and then consented to be wrecked. A thousand kisses deep, I'm turning tricks, I'm getting fixed. On Boogie Street, I guess they won't exchange the gifts that you were meant to keep. And quiet is the thought of you, the file on you. What we forgot to do. A thousand kisses deep.
Leonard Cohen and 1,000 Kisses Deep.
Beautiful.
As chosen by Jazz Coleman, who is my guest on the mixtape today. Jazz, I wanted to throw a few things at you from your Wikipedia entry.
Yes.
Because Wikipedia is an unknown quantity, right? And this could be fiction. We just don't know.
I've never seen it.
Well, I don't use phones.
I don't use phones or computers. So just launch away. Yeah.
Okay.
What does it say?
One, and I'm pretty sure this one is true, is that you studied in 1979 in Cairo, completing a study of Arabic quarter tones.
That was 1989.
That was 1989.
Yes.
Okay. Yes.
But yes, that's absolutely true.
Can you tell me what an Arabic quarter tone is?
Well, when you look at a piano of white notes and black notes, okay, and if you count the notes an octave, right, you know what that is. Well, actually, there's 13 notes, including the black notes, that make up an octave. Okay, so in between a white note and a black note, there's a note, which we actually had once upon a time before it was ironed out by J.S. Bach in his well-tempered clavichord. But that's another story altogether. So when a Western ear hears quarter tones, they sort of twitch because their oral capacity hasn't adjusted to these sounds. But basically, they're little mini trapdoors of hells, if you like. I say hells because in the mystery tradition, fractions are normally associated with demons or jinns. Mm-hmm. But anyway, back then, I was the only Western student at an Arabic conservatoire. I did 6 months there, enough to learn what I needed to learn before I did Songs from the Victorious City, which is really my first orchestral piece. And that was my beginnings with Eastern music. You see, here's the thing. As an individual of mixed race, part of me belongs in the East. Mm-hmm. And that part of me as a composer that belonged in the East ran about the age of 22. It started really pulling. It was to do with my sort of cultural identity, I suppose. I had a cultural identity crisis of who am I.
But is your heritage, is it Anglo-Indian?
That's correct, yeah.
Let me go to my second Wikipedia fact, or possibly not. Mm-hmm. It says you studied international banking for 3 years in Switzerland.
That's true, but not in a sort of... It's the history of international banking, actually.
I see. I was wondering.
Yeah, it's Dirts, which is a very different thing.
Yeah, it is.
And the location is right, but the circumstances are much more complex. That's like with it. A friend who was an international banker who I was hanging out with, right. who really became a mentor to me and still is, you know. I have to explain this. What I did... at a certain stage in my life was I made a short list of all the people who are living that I really admire their work, you see. And so not just in areas of orchestration, but areas of architecture, of spirituality, and certainly in occultism and magic and all the fraternities, etc. I could keep going on. Mm. And then in parapsychology, I had Yuri Geller, and then I had many great people. I worked with the Queen's genealogist, Sir Lawrence Gardner. He's the guy, basically, he was employed by the palace to put Charles and Diana together. So he was one of my mentors for 10 years. And I did my first opera at the Royal Opera House with him as my librettist, basically. And so I learned a lot about many, many things through many different people, but a very unconventional route. Basically, I chose my own syllabus, you could say, of many different things. And I've got a very unconventional approach to education. I believe I've self-educated, I'll be honest about it. I've self-educated and I've done it myself. I have an extremely high IQ. I always thought I was stupid, but I have a very high IQ, higher than my brother. My brother is one of the US's top scientists.
Oh, yes. Yeah.
And so to learn that I had a higher IQ than him was, this is mind-blowing. And my mum said, that's why we pushed you so hard. And I said, well, it didn't work, did it? So I was a failure, you could say, really, in my early years, you know, after I left school. And look at the way it is these days. I mean, the kids, if they don't have qualifications or they don't go to university, you're a no one in this world, and that just sucks. I think it's just bullshit. And I like to think of the principles of self-education in my life. I like to think there's another way for people who aren't necessarily academic, who've got an oral visual intelligence like myself. There's another way to do it, and you can do it on your own, and that is, again, make a short list of all your heroes who are living and then go and find them. You know, and that's all I did. I can't mention this guy's name because he comes to New Zealand. But he's one of the big banking families in the world. He's a recipient of the Federal Reserve somewhere, a descendant of the first people who signed the Federal Reserve Act. Yes.
This third fact is one that I'm quite skeptical of. It says you're an ordained priest with a church in New Zealand.
Well, that's a bit dodgy, but that's a bit dodgy, actually. Which is to say, by the age of 12, I could recite 150 psalms from memory.
Wow.
I've studied the Christian religion. Mm-hmm.
Were you raised as a Christian?
No, my parents are atheists.
Right.
I became very religious at a very early age,
right,
much to the dismay of my parents, I have to point out.
Right.
Yeah, because, you know, my parents are both teachers and they refused to participate in the Christian kind of Lord's Prayer at the schools, the respective schools that they taught in.
So where does the church in New Zealand come into it?
Well, I was thinking at one point about becoming a priest.
Is that right?
Yes, yeah. and I came very close to it. And the truth of the matter is, I can actually take weddings and stuff. I am.
Gotcha.
I don't want to talk about which church it is, but
you start getting requests.
Part of it is true that I am a priest of a church, but it's not a New Zealand church. But I have taken services at New Zealand churches. Yes.
Amazing. Let's go to your third song, and it's by Alex Harvey. The song is called Faithula.
Well, this is the one song all the members of Killing Joke could agree on when we were teenagers.
Right.
It's this one song. And the reason why I like to play this is because the current generation, most of them haven't heard of this band. And when you consider this recording, I think it was 1972, this recording. And Alex Harvey playing, well, they made it to Madison Square Gardens. And this song still does it for me.
If your body's feeling bad, and it's the only one you have, you wanna take away the pain, go out walking in the rain, watch the flowers go to bed. Your spirit never have to grieve. All you got to do is believe. The faith healer. The faith healer. All you got to do is feel. Your body's gonna stop to feel. Fingertips and holy fire, everlasting sweet desire. It don't matter what the doctor said, a healer man sail away. Immortality for miracles can come to you. Like we'll be right back.
was Alex Harvey, Faith Healer, as chosen by Jazz Coleman, who was my guest on the mixtape today. We've sort of touched on social media and the internet. This is a quote from you from 6 years ago. You said, people have access now to amazing amounts of information, but their attention spans are getting shorter. Their focus is gone.
Facts, yes.
It's all about instant gratification. I think that a lot of the great thinkers couldn't achieve what they did mm-hmm. through a computer. I mean, these are things that I worry about a lot as well, and I think a lot of people do increasingly. It's sort of like we didn't know what we were signing up for when
I agree.
The internet was...
I mean, when I started doing lectures in the 80s, you normally did 20 minutes before you broke things up with music or visuals. Now you do 5 minutes.
Is that right?
Yes.
Wow.
Yeah, I mean, actually, there's a book called The Shallows, I think it's called, and it tells you of the terrible effects that the internet's actually had on human intelligence. And that really sort of is, in a nutshell, amongst other, there's many other reasons why I don't really use computers or I don't like phones, and unless people, normally people shove them into my hand so they can find me. But right. But generally speaking, in order for Carla to find me, that's my manageress, she has to ring other people who I'm in the same room at the right time with, and that's how it works with me. I mean, you know, if I ask you to have a bug on you all the time, so that all your conversations, you say no, but there again, you carry around a mobile device. Not that I've got anything to hide, I haven't, I'm just a musician. But the point being is, since the Snowden revelations, well, that and, you know, look at what's happening. You walk down the street, you see everybody on their little boxes. It's exactly as Huxley said it would be.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Yes. Aldous Huxley.
Yeah, yep. It sure is. And it's going that way. It's just almost as if they picked the design to sort of... which leads me on to sort of the origins. We had a very interesting conversation in the tour bus between members of Killing Joke. We're talking about the origins of the counterculture. Well, actually, the truth of it is that the origins of counterculture in the 60s, it came out of Tavistock Institute of Human Relations.
Okay.
You know, and I know this. I know this for a fact. You know, memes such as pop music, cool, and teenagers. These memes. This is Tavistock jargon. Basically, right. The counterculture of the 60s was manufactured along with the LSD by the Learys and the rest of them. We've met them. We've met all these people. I mean, I'm R.D. Lang, Leary. I've met all these people over, and they've all admitted that they were paid for by intelligence agencies to do these kind of experiments. And and the reason why I bring this up is because it's connected to Killing Joke's beginnings, you see. When I started in 78 with Big Paul Ferguson, we met at a house that was full of psychologists, but mostly psychiatrists. And the kind of psychiatrists I'm talking about are people who already got their doctorates and stuff. And they were all working at the Tavistock Institute. And one of these guys was, I'll call him Steve. He was the guy who named the band Killing Joke.
Right.
That's right.
Okay.
And he started talking to us about the coming rule by corporations and basic behavior modification and the fact that he'd signed the Official Secrets Act. And this is when he was off his head on something. And all these other things that really profoundly affected Big Paul and myself, the way we saw things. So we had an unfair advantage from the very, very beginning about the way the world was going. We were informed. Yeah, you know, by somebody on the inside, absolutely, who was basically cracking up. Basically, he did something. He called his work at that time. He said he was an industrial psychiatrist, and I thought, what the f is a industrial psychiatrist? Yeah. And then of course, over many months, he told us about his work on groups of people, behavior modification, et cetera, and is your idea really your idea, and, you know, what you can do with advertising, and et cetera. It went all this kind of stuff, and that was the beginning of it all.
And you've seen this sort of play out since
then. Well, yes, that's right, that's right, yes.
When you travel around the world, as you do, is your impression that, because, you know, one of the things that I worry about, particularly with social media, and is that it's sort of fostering division. It's not bringing us closer. It's pushing us apart.
I agree with you.
Is that something that you've seen when you've traveled around the world?
Well, yes.
I mean, is that your sense of that,
massively, yeah, causing fragmentation. I mean, let's be honest about it. Movements such as punk couldn't really happen now. Because of social media, not in the same way, you know, or any big movement. I don't think so. Everything's people have got too much choice.
Yes.
You see, that's the thing. It's like having a 72-track studio or limiting yourself to a 16 or 24-track. People have got too many choices again.
A lot of people don't listen to albums, they listen to songs.
That's right. Mm. I mean, basically, it's smarter for a band these days to do an EP than an LP because people simply don't have the attention span. Sometimes, I've been on tour with Tool, and these guys, the average length, I saw their set list, Tool set list, and I thought, they're only playing 9 songs. Well, of course, I didn't realise how long the bloody songs were.
Yeah,
so maybe
right.
That trend is changing. In the 70s, bands used to play like 15, 20-minute tracks. Tool have started this kind of tradition again.
Have you become a fan of Tool, being on the road with them?
I do like all of their music, and they'll be coming here, of course, in February.
I may
even sing with Maynard, who knows. if I'm here, I will probably sing with Maynard. I do like their music. They're children of Killing Joke. Well, I've known them for 25 years since their band started. We've known each other well.
You mentioned Tool being the children of Killing Joke.
Mm.
And obviously,
one of
this
our
is,
many children, of course.
Well, this is
Nirvana,
what I'm going to say.
Metallica,
yeah.
And we could keep going on.
I mean, the one that springs to mind for me is Nine Inch Nails. I was a big Nine Inch Nails fan.
And there's Kate Bush as well.
There's a lineage there.
We played Glasgow Barrowlands. And guess who's a big fan of Killing Joke? Susan Boyle. Can you believe it?
Really?
Yeah. To be honest, that's all very nice, but the way Killing Joke works is we don't spend too much time thinking about the past. That's done. You know, in the last 13, 14 months, I've done 3 American tours. 1 world tour, and a European tour. Yeah. Most bands wouldn't work so hard at this stage in your life,
that's
you know.
That's true. Yeah. At the earlier stages of their lives.
One person who changed my life was this, he's a famous Czech pop singer, but who he is isn't important. But he said, you know, after I finished alcohol, he said, it's important to keep a certain level of fitness. He said, you should always be able to, like, do 35 press-ups, and you should be able to, like, lift your body up. Well, I learned that. I went out fishing on the barrier. And of course, there I was fishing away off the rocks, and the tide came in. And this was after I'd had an accident on my ankle. My foot was made of metal. Right. So anyway, the tide came in. I had to throw the rod away and go up the cliff face. And I didn't have enough upper body strength to pull myself up. And any other option would have been falling down to your death, basically. And so it was a very scary experience. And I thought to myself, if I get out of this, I'm going to put on some upper body weight, so I'm all right now. I can like do 10 pull-ups, and you know, and I'm good now. So these kind of things are important if you're going to do a lot of concerts. Your body on a gig day is like a spring, is a coiled spring, and it stays like that until the gig, and bang, release, you know, and you relax, and then the gig day again, coiled spring. It's like this. So it's this kind of. And this takes its toll after you do a lot of concerts, you know, at the end of all this. Recent studies in an American university said that basically rock musicians live 25% less than normal people.
Right.
And at that point, I became a composer. See, because composers live longer than normal people.
Right. Tell us. Yeah. Let's go to song number 4. It's a classic from the Sex Pistols, God Save the Queen.
I owe a lot of my classical career to the Shan Kidd family and Princess Diana's cousin, who I met all these people through, actually, Jimmy Page in his house, actually. And, you know, I had this marvellous day when I went to use the library at Jimmy Page's house. And I met this very beautiful lady there, and she saw that I was printing out my first symphony. Because Jimmy, he really helped me with these things. And he was the first person I knew who had a Xerox machine back in those days, you know. And so he helped me print my symphony out. And And there was this beautiful lady there. She said, and so where do you live? And I said, oh, I live in an awful place with a guitarist. And she said, oh, my poor darling, I've got a little house in Notting Hill Gate. You can have that if you like. We were in there like rats up an aqueduct the next day, Walker and myself. We'd moved in. And then suddenly we're in this world where, like, we've got one guy looking after us. He gives us a Rolls-Royce Camargue. And coming around this house, you've got stones coming around. I realised that this house is basically used for other rock musicians of no names mentioned, where they go and have a lot of fun, basically, you know? Mm-hmm. And it was a wild house, and I lived there until I got married, basically. And then one of the other members of the band moved in. It's a very interesting time. I'm always grateful to Jimmy. I mentioned Jimmy Page because he was like our dad, really, or something like that, an elder member of the rock fraternity. And when we were younger, like in our early 20s and even now, he really helped us in terms of how to survive some of these, the obvious crises that turn up in the industry. And he was a very positive spiritual force in my life. Most people don't. He's a very shy person. We both love Arabic music, Jimmy Page and myself, and we talk for hours about the different Arabic artists, as well as mysticism. And of course, Jimmy has the biggest occult library outside of the Vatican.
Is that right?
Yeah, he does. Wow. Yeah. I mean, you know, back in the day, he used to get me to hunt for first editions of occult masterpieces, and I'd flog them to him. You know, and he said, I'll pay you a good price for it. And so we had this thing going. Anyway, where are we?
God Save the Queen, The Pistols.
Yeah, this was a revolutionary moment. It was the first wave of punk. God Save the Queen, I mean, it was just a deeply felt sentiment, I think, when this came out. And I think people probably feel like that now when they read about the excesses of the royal family. But when it comes to Aotearoa, I have to be clear about this, that I'm very happy that the Crown still has involvement with this country because, you know, the Waitangi Treaty is with the Crown and it's something we must protect. Mm-hmm. So I'm a royalist for New Zealand, but for the UK, well, there you go. I'm not really part of the UK anymore.
Let's listen to Sex Pistols, God Save the Queen. Sex Pistols, God Save the Queen.
Fantastic.
As chosen by Jazz Coleman, my guest on the mixtape today. We've just got time for one more song, but I wanted to put something to you first. It is another factoid that I found out about you. You're a supporter of the concept of environmental sustainability.
Mm-hmm.
You have invested in eco-villages.
That's right.
In Chile.
And Peru.
And Peru.
That's
oh, right.
Right. That's, I'm currently living in Peru.
Right.
Yeah. And I've got some friends, one group near Casco and one in Chile, and they have these earth communities where they're basically self-sufficient. And I stay in touch with them. In fact, let's be honest about it. You know, look at the way the world's going. Things could happen like Argentina, where people tried to take their money out of a cash point machine and there were no banks and they didn't work. So when that happens, there's normally 3 days worth of food in any city,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
And that's basically our starting point. The most important thing now is that we must increase food production.
Mm-hmm.
And we have to think collectively. So the earth community idea is really kind of part of that, the sustainability idea. Because look, we cannot have infinite growth. So we have to replace this with sustainability and human well-being. If you consider places like Costa Rica, where I'm also staying for part of my time, I mean, they don't have a navy or an army. Mm-hmm. And they spend all that money basically on the infrastructure.
Mm-hmm.
Well, consider that. I mean, and anyway, it remains to be seen whether you think that a couple of frigates and a couple of jets would really save you. Also, what we have to do is, I mean, my father's dying wish to me, he said to me, I've thought about it. He said, you have to do something called a forest in a day. He said, you get the school children to plant a whole forest in a day. And that's his dying wish to me.
Mm.
So that's something I feel compelled to do wherever I can do it.
Mm.
And so these are the things that are dear to me. Increasing food production. I give free music lessons to the United Nations now. And yeah. That's my message, that we have to think collectively and think of everyone's backyard and parks, and we have to increase food supply for ourselves here in Aotearoa.
Let's go to your last song. We're going to go to The Doors' Unknown Soldier. This is the arrangement by yourself and Nigel Kennedy.
This record changed my life. I mean, Nigel is still the greatest violinist in the world, and I was friends, because Ray Manzarek's passed on now.
Mm.
With the three, at the time I record this, with the three surviving members of The Doors, and it was with their consent and their blessing that I took on this project, which is really something that I was passionate about.
Mm.
But Nigel, I've never been able to communicate with him since I quit booze, to be honest, because like, he likes a drink, Nigel.
Right.
But I'm going to meet up with him soon. I'll tell you how it goes. But he's a lively character. I'm going to Vietnam for the first time in a couple of months, and I'm going there to meet the Minister of Culture and the National Orchestra, and I'm going to be doing this piece there because. I'm saying The Doors consider, because I wrote basically all The Doors music, but in genuinely speaking, I wrote them not so much on the piece you're going to hear now, but many of them in Vietnamese scales, basically. And I had the blessing after, I mean, the surviving members just loved it so much. And it's one of my treasured recordings of all time, really. The Unknown Soldier, I mean, I wrote the whole album as a memorial to the Vietnam War, which is why I'm going to Vietnam. It's almost like a pilgrimage. So it's probably a good way to end this interview.
Jazz Coleman, it has been such a pleasure to have you in the studio.
It's great to be back home, I'll tell you. I'm going to go and have a pie.
Awesome. We will leave you with The Doors, Unknown Soldier, arrangement by Jazz and Nigel Kennedy. Thank you, mate.